Faith Day, Men of Faith Day, as we celebrate together God's gifts to us on this very special day. Take a moment, if you would, to wave to everybody around that we are all here today. And it sure makes the greeting efficient when we just wave at everybody, that's for sure. So, order of services are on before us in our bulletin. We'll follow it as it leads us this day. With that said, we begin with our opening hymn, Just As I Am, Without Monthly, hymn number 570. Lord's blessings as we worship this day. Grace and forgiveness from God.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by all we have done, and by all we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called, ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And instead, by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Once again this week, we read responsibly the intro for this day. It is from Psalm 56. For you have delivered my soul from death, yes, my feet from falling, that I may walk before God in the light of life.
When I am afraid, I put my trust in you.
In God, whose word I praise, in God I trust. I shall not be afraid. What can flesh do to me?
In God, whose word I praise. In the Lord, whose word I praise.
In God I trust. I shall not be afraid. What can man do to me?
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
For you have delivered my soul from death, yes, my feet from falling, that I may walk before God in the light of life. In peace let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated as we sing together our hymn of praise.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, because your abiding presence always goes with us, keep us aware of your daily mercies, that we may live secure and content in your eternal love. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Continue with the readings appointed for this day. They're found in the back of your bulletin. Our Old Testament lesson for this now, the third Sunday after Pentecost, comes to us from Jeremiah chapter 20. O Lord, you have deceived me, and I was deceived. You are stronger than I, and you have prevailed. I have become a laughingstock all the day. Everyone mocks me. For whenever I speak, I cry out, I shout, violence and destruction. For the word of the Lord has become for me a reproach and derision all day long. If I say I will not mention him, or speak any more in his name, there is in my heart, as it were, a burning fire shut up in my bones, and I am weary with holding it in, and I cannot. For I hear many whispering, terror is on every side. Denounce him, let us denounce him, say all my close friends, watching for my fall. Perhaps he will be deceived. Then we can overcome him and take our revenge on him. But the Lord is with me as a dread warrior. Therefore my persecutors will stumble. They will not overcome me. They will be greatly shamed, for they will not succeed. Their eternal dishonor will never be forgotten. O Lord of hosts, who test the righteous, who sees the heart and the mind, let me see your vengeance upon them, for to you have I committed my cause. Sing to the Lord, praise the Lord, for he has delivered the life of the needy from the hand of evildoers. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle is from Romans chapter 6. Let not sin, therefore, reign in your mortal bodies to make you obey their passions. Do not present your members to sin as instruments for unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and your members to God as instruments for righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. What then? Are we to sin because we are not under law, but under grace? By no means. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness? But thanks be to God, that you who were once slaves of sin have become obedient from the heart to the standard of teaching to which you were committed, and having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. I am speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations. For just as you once presented your members as slaves to impurity and to lawlessness, leading to more lawlessness, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness, leading to sanctification. When you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. But what fruit were you getting at that time from the things of which you are now ashamed? The end of those things is death. But now that you have been set free from sin and have become slaves of God, the fruit you get leads to sanctification and its end, eternal life. The wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I invite you to stand with me once again, if you're able, as we honor the Lord's Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 10th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
These 12 Jesus sent out, instructing them. Brother will deliver brother over to death, and the father his child. And children will rise against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all for my name's sake. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. When they persecute you in one town, flee to the next. For truly I say to you, you will not have gone through all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. A disciple is not above his teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for the disciple to be like his teacher, and the servant like his master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebul, how much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered that will not be revealed, or hidden that will not be known. What I tell you in the dark, say in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim on the housetops. And do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? And not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. But even the hairs of your head are all numbered. Fear not, therefore. You are of more value than many sparrows. So everyone who acknowledges me before men, I will also acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I will also deny before my Father who is in heaven. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, O Christ.
Please be seated as we sing our hymn of the day, a favorite of mine. Ray, of course, being so mindful of us, he saw that it was my 23rd anniversary of my ordination this past week, so he asked me what was one of the songs or hymns played, and this is one of my favorites that was played now a couple decades ago, so he indulged me to lead this song this day. We sing Christ Be My Leader. Didn't really want to listen to what he had to say. The name of Jesus Christ. Christ in whom we stand, as we just sang, nothing can touch my salvation because with Jesus I reign. Dear friends, in his name. Have you ever been so afraid that you were kept from something you really wanted to do? Are you thinking, boy, Pastor, that's kind of a dumb question because we're living in the midst of a pandemic? Think of something else that you really wanted to do and you didn't because you were afraid to do it. We might have a few of those out there throughout our time on earth where we wanted to do something and simply did it because we were afraid of what might happen. Let's transition this quickly to our faith. Have you ever not spoken or kept your faith hidden because you were worried or afraid about the response, the result of standing for your faith? Have you ever been afraid of that? Of speaking out your Christian faith? I would dare to say all of us, if we're honest, would say there has been a time, or maybe many times, where I wanted to say something, but I didn't because I wasn't sure how I would get a response. What would be spoken back to me? We live in very tense times as the things that are going on around us occur right in front of us. None of us are limited or let go or removed from it. We all are connected in the midst of these difficult days. And sometimes that causes things to be even a little bit more tense. There are things that we know Scripture teaches about. The value of human life from conception all the way to the grave. And yet sometimes it's difficult to speak on that because we're not so sure if we should say anything at all, even though it's right there in Scripture. One example of many examples that we say we believe what the Scriptures teach, but we're worried to speak because someone else might find fault or flat out disagree. And so the temptation is at least, if not a reality, for us to just remain silent. Jesus Christ, in talking to his disciples in this text, a continuation, I think, from the last couple of meditations that I've given you from 2 weeks ago, the Great Commission, Jesus calling us to make disciples and to do all of those things, remembering he's with us always, to last week, the things that get in our way, things to know as we go. Today we look at the gospel lesson, Jesus talking to the disciples about the things that may cause them fear. And the fear of sharing your faith might interfere with you actually getting it done. That's why I named the title for our sermon today, Jesus Keeps Fear from Interfering. Thanks be to God. I have three of these again today that the disciples felt, had, experienced. Three fears, and thanks be to God, Jesus answers each one of them with a promise. A promise for them that I pray gave them great comfort, and I pray gives us great comfort and boldness as we live in the midst of these times today. The first fear that Jesus talks about in Matthew chapter 10 is the fear of failing. The disciples are worried that what they say, how they live, might come to naught. It might not make a difference. It might not make a dent. People may not listen, and they will fear failing. We know what that's like. Maybe we haven't thought about it in our spiritual context, but we know what that's like. I know as a parent, I don't want to fail my kids. I want to be a good dad. I don't want to fail with my neighbors or my coworkers. You know that. We were raised to do a good job. We were raised to have pride in our work and in our families. And so you might had a little fear of failing yourself in a variety of places. The disciples had great fear in themselves that, who am I? Who's going to listen to me? What if I fail? What if nobody listens? Jesus has a promise for them and for us. Plainly stated, he says this, my message will never fail. I who have overcome sin and death and the power of the devil, my message will not go out and return void. It will accomplish its purpose for which it was sent. Those words from the Old Testament. I pray that it was liberating for them, and I pray it's liberating for us. We don't know the results, of course. We don't know how the Spirit is going to work. But God doesn't call us to convert people, because we don't have that power. That's the power of the Spirit. But he does call us to share, to live, to act, to respond in kind, in faith, to those around us. And to not worry about what might happen. Those are good words for me, because I can't count how many people over the years I've talked to about my faith, about the Christian faith, and then I never saw them again. And I wondered, what could I have said better? What more could I have done? Was it me? Was it something I said? Was it something I did? Maybe I failed them. Thanks be to God for forgiveness, in case it did happen. But the comfort for us, for me, his message doesn't fail. His message is powerful and has authority in and of itself. And it's not my work anyway. It's God's work as we proclaim it. The second fear the disciples had, which was really pressing for them, well-founded indeed, was the fear of death. They knew the stakes were high. They knew that people right in front of their faces told them what they thought and what they were going to do to them. And so there was this fear of death. We might not feel that today, but certainly in my 23 years of ministry, churches are more of a target today than they were when I first started back in 1997. I don't fear death, but it wouldn't surprise me over the next 23 years if the Lord gives me that time that things might become a little more tense and they might even try to tell me what I can say or what I can't say. Wouldn't surprise me. I don't fear death. Jesus has a promise for them and for us as well. Life eternal. A bodily resurrection. Have no fear of those who can kill the body, but rather have more fear in the one who can kill the soul. The one who can, because of your unbelief, remove you from his presence. That's what hell is, apart from God. We have no idea what that's like. Even on our worst day, God is with us, providing for us. Even on our worst day, even if we would speak out the worst words we could against God, he's still here. But for those who don't believe, who die in unbelief, eternally separated from God. But for us, the promise of Jesus is we needn't fear death because he's ours. Like we just sang, in Jesus, we still stand. Again, that's liberating, I pray, for you and for me as we proclaim this message. Even death can't harm us. The last one is maybe a little bit more connected to us this day. And that was the fear of want. They had fear that they might lose some of the necessities of life. That they might be treated poorly because they would be unpopular. That hostility to them as proclaimers of Jesus would cause them to not get jobs, would cause them to not receive fair treatment. And so the fear was, how can I provide for my family? How am I going to be able to take care of the necessities of life if people don't like what I have to say and they respond accordingly to that? I think that might be something that comes a little closer to home for us this day. Because there are those out there that are capable, but because they are Christian, they are looked at differently. What if I do the church thing and I miss the practice? Well, my kids won't get to play. Well, I don't want that, rightly so. And so something might come up within them, a fear of, I can't let that happen because of this. Or a coach might say, you're not going to get this unless you do what I want you to do. And so there's a fear of want. I want this to happen. I would like for this to happen, but it may not. I may not be accepted if people knew really what I believed, what was in my heart of hearts. I'm afraid to speak, to live according to that. In a sense, there might be a cost. Jesus says it as well. I have a promise for you for that as well. He who loves you dearly continues to do everything that needs to be done so that we might be provided for. Maybe a little different because of who we are and what we believe, but the promise of God continues to be true and real, even if it comes at a cost. Jeremiah was a great example for us as he proclaims violence and destruction, as he tells the people of Israel, then, you better shape up. You better get your stuff in order because you are not following God's will. Violence and destruction is on its way because of what you are now doing. Even though he was extremely passionate and insightful, he was, no surprise to you or me, extremely unpopular. He was outnumbered by many. He could have feared. He thought about not speaking out. But in this text, we have these wonderful words. If I say I will not mention him or speak any more in his name, if I just stop talking, if I just quit, there's a fire, there's in my heart, as it were, a burning fire shut up in my bones. And I am weary with holding it in, and I cannot. Oh, that we all would be so bold. I see that, I read that, and I see Jeremiah, and I'm like, oh, I want to be more like that. I want to be more bold, even in the midst of the pressures of the world coming in on me. To say, I can't. This burning fire, this spirit is so strong within me that even if I was on a wall and someone was going to take my life, I still would speak up. I pray that happens, if that would be the case. To be so bold that burning fire is so strong that I cannot hold it in. Why? Because of what's at stake. It's not my house. It's not some stuff. It's eternal life. It's life everlasting that we're talking about. To Jeremiah, it was far too important. He had to speak. He couldn't keep quiet because he wanted them to realize what they were doing and also to remind them of God's love and mercy and his forgiveness in the midst of this. He hadn't left them. He was still there, ready, willing, and able to forgive and to lift them up, to bind up their broken hearts. Because God's purpose is always for us to have a right relationship with him. God's not surprised when you or I are rebellious. When we close our mouths when we should speak. When we say something we shouldn't. When we do something we shouldn't. Or vice versa. God knows that. He knows you. He knows me. He knows our hearts. And yet he still loves us. He still pushes through, continuing to bring us his word. He did it for Jeremiah. He does it for you and me as well. There's a lot of fears in our world. Some of them are fears that we have that have nothing to do with our faith, and some smack dab right in the middle of our spiritual life. I pray when it comes to those faith struggles, we will listen once again to the promises of God, a message that will not fail. A promise of life everlasting. A promise of provision for our earthly life until we see him face to face. I pray those calm you so that our fear doesn't interfere with our faith. May God grant us his grace so that we may boldly go wherever he leads us. In Jesus' name, amen. May the peace of God, which surpasses all our human understanding, guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus for the life everlasting. I invite you to stand with me if you're able as we continue by professing our Christian faith this day with the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all the worlds, God of God, light of light, very God, very God. Begotten and not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men, for our salvation, came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us in our righteous Father. He suffered in his buried. On the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven. And sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead, and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, and for all people according to their needs. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the gift of divine peace and of pardon, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the Holy Church throughout the world, and for the proclamation of the gospel and the calling of all to faith, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this nation, that God's gracious word have free course, and that his righteousness prevails, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all people, that we be preserved from discord and strife, that God grant us protection in every time of need, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all those in need, for the hungry and homeless, for the widowed and orphaned, for the sick and dying, and for all those who care for them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Heavenly Father, this day we ask your blessings upon Jackie and Dave. Be with Megan and Joanne as well. Be with these, your servants, those we name before you in our hearts. Continue to be with us as a community, as a state, as a country, as we work through the things that have been laid before us. Keep us safe and healthy. And those who are struggling, that according to your will, they would be well once again. Be with us with the divisions that we have within our country. May we be strengthened in them. To know that just as we are brothers and sisters unified in you, we might be unified together in this nation as well. Finally, for these and for all of our needs of body and soul, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy. Christ have mercy. Lord have mercy.
I invite you to remain standing. Of course, you can give your offerings if you wish on your way out as we continue with the service in a second. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created, sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy, receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-manly sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood, as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth, to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you, for the forgiveness of all your sins. Do this as often as you drink it. Remembrance of me." We pray again the prayer our Lord has taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Please be seated once again for communion this day. We'll have our two stations. If you come down between the first and second bay, and the third and fourth bay, for communion, then you can just peel out around to return to your seat.
Thank you.
preserve you in the one true faith unto life everlasting. Peace be with you. Amen. I invite you to stand with me if you're able as we continue in prayer. Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, you have given us a foretaste of the feast to come in the Holy Supper of your Son's body and blood. Keep us firm in the true faith throughout our days of pilgrimage, that on the day of his coming, we may together with all your saints celebrate the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Please be seated as we sing our closing hymn, hymn 815, God of Grace.
Thank you.
this day. Looking at the Romans 6 text, our epistle lesson, and preach on that for our Bible study today. We're going to look at the entire chapter, so that will be on tap for our Bible study time here just in a little bit. So, any other announcements for us this week? Anything to highlight? Next week we will have an installation of officers and board members, so have an opportunity to welcome back those who are continuing on the board or changing the board, and then of course welcoming in you, those who are coming on the boards for the first time. And so that'll be next week as we gather together. And note of some things coming up here pretty soon as we get close to July. And we thank God for things going on with COVID-19. We're in phase 2 now, so our worship opportunities, we continue to have our Thursday evening and then our 2 on Sunday morning, so more opportunities for people to worship and to come in here. So we're thankful that we keep seeing positive results. We pray that will continue as we see little sparks in places around the country popping up again, and we pray that, of course, that doesn't happen here, and that those places will be quickly kind of spanning and settle back down again. So we keep those, of course, always in our prayers. If nothing else at this time, God's peace to you as we rejoice in a God who comes to us with his promises evermore, to be bold as we share his faith. May we do so as he leads us.